Orion Spring presents Saturn Returns, written and read by Caggie Dunlop. To the listener, I hope this book has found you when you need it. Introduction. I've heard it said that if your 20s are a mock exam for life, your Saturn return is your first real assessment. When mine arrived, it seemed I hadn't been revising. Regardless of your belief or understanding of astrology, I'm sure you'll be familiar with all the symptoms that come with this great transition that arrives in our late 20s. A sense of confusion, turmoil, and wondering about your purpose in life. For those who are new to the idea of Saturn return, let me introduce you. Your Saturn return is a key astrological point in your life's calendar and is often described as a true coming of age. It takes place as the planet Saturn returns to the exact zodiac sign, degree, and house it was in when you were born. This cycle takes between 27 and 29 and a half years, and Saturn transits each sign for a period of 2.5 years. As such, you're likely to experience your Saturn return between the ages of 27 and 31. The years between our late 20s into our early 30s are a key transitional time that can bring lots of thoughts and feelings to the surface, causing us to re-examine our lives thus far. When this was happening, I struggled to see the meaning in the madness. I now understand that this was a pivotal and important push from the universe in my coming of age, my all-important Saturn return. So how do you know if you're experiencing your Saturn return? You're in your late 20s, you're suddenly having existential thoughts about your life and the direction in which it's going. You've outgrown people and friends. You no longer have interest in the same things you did in your early 20s. You have a desire to change everything up. You feel like you're being drop-kicked in the face and every harsh life lesson is hitting you all in one go. Since Saturn is strongly associated with structure, discipline, and karma, you can bet that this cosmic event won't come quietly. In its own special way, it'll teach you all the lessons you need to live your life as the most powerful and authentic version of yourself you can possibly be, like a crash course in personal growth from the universe. This is until its next visit and further initiation during your second Saturn return that comes at 59. Where people tend to look back and review their lives so far, take stock and think about building legacy. Confusion and doubt are likely to be a part of this process, feelings I know all too well. With this book, I hope to help alleviate some of that anxiety and help you to trust that you're on the right path, to demonstrate that your Saturn return is working for you and not against you. This was also the key motivation I felt when launching my podcast by the same name as this book in March 2020. The podcast has given me the opportunity to speak with countless incredible experts, writers, spiritual thinkers, and thought leaders, in turn offering an insight into some of the major themes we experience during our Saturn return. This has provided a toolkit for how to navigate this challenging time. We've covered careers, relationships, money, vulnerability, spirituality, healing, and everything in between. I've brought all of this together, along with my own experiences and insights, here in my first book as an offering to you and to my younger self, who I know would have appreciated these teachings. Welcome to your final initiation into adulthood. Buckle up, get ready, and remember, Saturn is not out to get you, rather just to let you know this. You reap what you sow. Gulp. For 27 years, I hadn't been sowing at all. Post-Saturn return, I can see I've changed a lot. I've grown and yet simultaneously come home to myself. I guess it's been a journey of discovery and rediscovery. I haven't figured it all out, but I'm definitely more certain of who I am and what I want. I hope that by sharing my Saturn return journey, I can help you to gain more clarity on your own path. I can't tell you what step to take next, My aim is simply to remind you that you already know what to do. Included are some of the practices and exercises that I found useful, some esoteric, some pragmatic, and some stories from people I found wise. Some might resonate with you and some might not. I just want you to know that there's a plethora of knowledge and ways of doing things out there beyond the status quo. I want you to dance in your uniqueness and not be shy in doing so as I teach you how to take ownership over every part of your life, to rewrite the narrative if you're not liking the story. The years preceding my Saturn return were wonderful and awful, filled with heartbreaks, mistakes, different cities and different lives. They were extreme and unanchored, sailing at full speed with no clear direction. I moved countries several times, either to reinvent myself or to find myself. Looking back, I wonder if it was sometimes just a futile attempt to outrun my own shadow. I chopped and changed careers, boyfriends, friends, and in this process, I failed, fumbled, and fell. This started to feel like a rotational pattern in my life. My early 20s were outrageous years. The brink of any new decade has a sweet scent of novelty about it. They were unusual years in the sense that the first three were spent on a reality TV show. But in terms of the themes I'll cover in this book, these years were no different to anyone else my age, albeit at times perhaps a little more heightened. I believe your 20s are a necessary series of events, of messy experiences that provide you with the knowledge and tools you need to establish who you are in your adult life. Sometimes you only know who you are by discovering who you aren't. At 30, after a decade of self-discovery, in a way the slate feels clean again. We're constantly outgrowing people, places, and things. Our lives are always changing. This inevitable process can be daunting, but attempting to avoid change is like fighting with the tide. It'll only drag you under in the end. I hope that by sharing my story, you might feel less alone. Understanding your Saturn return might also provide you with some tools and insights to look at life differently, as it did for me. I write as truthfully as I can about my own struggles and experiences in the process, which may resonate with some of you, but I demonstrate its uniqueness to my chart and encourage you to look into your own. When I moved to Los Angeles at 27, something in me shifted. My behaviors and coping mechanisms that had sufficed for the last decade were wearing thin. I felt I was being shoved unwillingly into confronting a new stage of life and was being forced to look at myself head on. And I didn't like it. The cycles I was repeating, or more accurately, the mistakes I was making were taking their toll, and the repercussions felt increasingly severe. The youthful charm and naivety that I relied on wasn't working anymore. I knew better, so why wasn't I doing better? It felt like I was being shouted at by a draconian school teacher, snapping a ruler across my knuckles, a teacher I'd soon come to know as Saturn. A lot of the time, I felt like a disappointment. I compared myself to friends who seemed to have it all figured out. It felt as if everyone had been sent the handbook of life and mine had got lost in the post. I embarked on this final chapter of my 20s, putting so much pressure on myself, emotionally, socially, romantically, that I had the weight of the world on my shoulders, with so much to do and so little time. Time that I was running out of. I lived these years with a what-if, victimhood mentality. What if I'd done things differently? What if I'd taken another road instead? This can be a paralyzing place to be, not moving forwards, only looking back. Once you're through your Saturn return, however, it offers you the vantage point to say, I'm glad things happened that way. As rough as it feels at the time, I believe this process of initiation during your Saturn return is about cutting away things that aren't meant for you. It'll present you with the obstacles so you can garner strength, preparing you for the next stage. It'll unburden you of things you no longer need to carry and reveal the goals you're here to pursue that are aligned with your intrinsic values. Trusting this process is the hard part. As soon as you step out of a victimhood mentality, You start to take ownership of your life rather than feeling at its mercy. You see the role you play in everything, where you've been irresponsible, where you need to take responsibility. The societal expectation is that when you reach 30, you should have it all figured out. At least, that was the messaging I had while I was growing up. My 20s were fun, but I'd been living for other people for so long that I hadn't really paid much attention to what I truly wanted. And living according to other people's expectations was becoming rather burdensome. It felt like I'd spent my entire life trying to be somebody else in order to fit in, chasing validation to feel loved and to be accepted, but never quite reaching any point of real satisfaction. After growing tired of the charade and the people-pleasing, I decided to do something that felt almost revolutionary. I decided to be myself. But after over a decade of pretending, I had little idea who that person actually was. I'd lost my way and my confidence. During those years, I became very isolated. Looking back, the isolation may or may not have been necessary. It was a self-inflicted exile because I didn't know how to maintain my values and integrity and continue to develop a sense of self when around others. I didn't know how to say no and would rather do what other people wanted than risk making them feel uncomfortable or disappointing them in some way. Drinking was a huge part of this, and sobriety is something I cover in this book. But unlearning the belief of be whoever you need to be to fit in took a lot of effort. I'd become so programmed to shapeshift that remaining still and grounded in one version of me felt unbearable at times. I was a professional chameleon, and that had been my method of survival. In this restless unease, I began dismantling the conditions I'd built over a lifetime. I began exploring aspects of myself that I'd cut away or denied, detaching the unhealthy coping mechanisms and unpacking everything that was underneath. I learned a new and very Saturnian quality, discipline, something that was almost as foreign to me as the concept of responsibility. I departed from an old way of living and everything that came with it to begin establishing and cultivating my own values. Your Saturn return feels like coming off stabilizers. A bit wonky at first, but you eventually get the hang of it. People began to appear in my life over that time in random and unexpected ways. I was connecting to people outside of my social circle, and these happened to be the people who opened my eyes to exploring the world differently, introducing me to teachers and practices I'd never heard of before, practices that would eventually lead me to finding myself again. When I was living in LA, I felt a significant shift and transition. I remember someone told me I was about to go through my Saturn return. But although I'd say I was always a spiritual person, I had little understanding of astrology. I wasn't prepared for what was to come, which is exactly why I started the Saturn Returns podcast and why I've written this book. It was only through hindsight that I realized that was exactly what was happening. If only I knew all this then. In a similar way that religion offers a framework and gives comfort, astrology has done that for me. Perhaps there's a construct in the chaos, a method in the madness. I've learned to take a lot more ownership over my life and become more grounded through my spiritual path. I've learned to trust in the unfolding of things with an ever-increasing appetite and curiosity, both to know and to share more. With a little help from my spirit guides I've met along the way, this book offers an honest account of my own unique path, which I hope will empower people to pursue their own. This isn't the story of someone who miraculously figured it all out, nor is it about being the perfect you. And this isn't just for 20-somethings. It's for anyone who's struggling to navigate the seas of change, and for those who are on a quest for authenticity. I hope anyone who listens to this will find solace in the knowledge that there's always hope on the other side. That I can be a friend from afar to let you know that you're not alone in what you're experiencing. Through events in my life and the parallels of astrology, I demonstrate that it isn't all as random or chaotic as you might think. And believe me when I say it's not personal, and it's not just happening to you. Interspersed with my stories and lessons are powerful and illuminating words of wisdom from my wonderful friend, personal spirit guide, and astrologer, Noura Bourni. I've gained so much from her rich and comforting insight over the years that has helped me to piece all of this together. I can't wait for you to do that too. Welcome to your Saturn return, your cosmic coming of age. Part 1. Why astrology? Two things fill the mind with ever new and increasing admiration and awe. The more often and steadily we reflect upon them, the starry heavens above me and the moral law within me. Immanuel Kant. For most of my life, I considered astrology a woo-woo and wacky thing, not giving it much serious thought. I associated it with vague, watered-down, generalised horoscopes in newspaper articles that, regardless of which sign you read, all sounded applicable to you. Being brought up within a Christian framework, I dismissed astrology, tarot, and other esoteric practices that are now part of my daily life as New Age mumbo-jumbo. Astrology was for strange people who wore baggy clothes and smelt like vegetables. Now perhaps I am one of those strange people who smell like vegetables. Who knows? Astrology's complexity, depth, and rich history has only become apparent to me over the last few years, and consequently, both my view and its significance in my life, as well as the general collective, has shifted. From the Sumerians to the Babylonians to ancient Egyptians, Mayans, or the Hindu civilizations, those who came before us knew the maps and codes that lay within the stars. This was in addition to the vast tapestry of knowledge within the greater cosmos around us, available for our own interpretation and guidance. World leaders and even dictators had personal astrologers by their sides, using the planet's movements to inform their strategies of attack. Over time, Christianity and empirical science began to diminish astrology's credibility and value. After the 18th century, with the rise of scientific materialism and when outer planets were discovered, astrology began its separation from science and astronomy, becoming categorized as superstitious, with astrologers labeled as charlatans. But it seems to be finding a renaissance within mainstream popular culture today. For those of us for whom religion plays less of a central role, we still seem to crave something spiritual and mystical that connects us. Something beyond touch or human measure. The inexplicable, the esoteric. Perhaps because we're living in a world where we're digitally more connected, yet lonelier than ever. For whatever reason, astrology is seeping back into our day-to-day lives. The cosmos and its vastness are things we may never fully understand, but they undeniably stir something within us, something we may only grasp for a fleeting moment as we stare at the night sky and realize our own significance within the galaxy, yet simultaneously feel how awe-inspiringly wonderful it is to be part of it. I believe in the power of anything that brings us out of ourselves and gives us perspective. Anything that humbles us or makes us see there's something far greater at play than just our own small lives. What better way to do this than marvel at the universe around us and to indulge in the notion that there's a dialogue of sorts between these two worlds, the internal and the external. I've had many debates with friends about astrology, about the moon and its effect on us. Often the disbelievers tried to beat me down with studies and facts and counter-arguments. However, what it boils down to is this. I believe that the validity of astrology and the birth chart is measured by how much it matters to someone. If it has meaning to someone, it matters. I believe that for the true expansion of our consciousness, we have to draw outside the lines of linear thought. When I look at Monet's water lilies, I don't question whether or not they are lilies, even though I know what I'm looking at is paint. His impression of a sunrise evokes the same emotion in me as the real thing. Astrology is for our impression and interpretation to help us navigate the collective and inner psyche. It gives us permission to feel what we are feeling and to feel seen. Our appetite for astrology reinforces our belief that we have a destiny and a purpose that goes beyond the boundaries of ego. And if nothing else, it can be a great tool for self-awareness and self-mastery. It isn't fate versus free will. It's a dance between the two. Sometimes it's not in the knowing, but the unknowing that paradoxically allows us to understand things and, in turn, ourselves. Perhaps not on a linear, logical level, but on a soul one. Astrology's uniqueness is that it's both deeply personal, yet simultaneously unifying. It's there for our comprehension and interpretation, both the starry skies above and the moral law within. What is astrology? Before we begin, it's important to introduce you to the absolute basics of astrology and to some of the terms that I'll be using throughout this book. Astrology is a huge subject and feels limitless in what you can learn, so I encourage you to do your own research and look into what interests you. For me, I gravitated towards it as a tool for building self-awareness and a deeper understanding of self. I'm interested in the more emotional applications of astrology and how it can affect both our thinking and our approach to life. It's a poetic means of storytelling and interpretation. Therefore, that's the focus of this book, in which I demonstrate how astrology and my life experiences run parallel to each other. In this book, you'll gain a better understanding of astrology and a deeper understanding of self, with a specific focus on Saturn and Saturn's return. Noura's astrological insight.
The word astrology finds its roots in the ancient Greek word astrologia, which means the study of something or the branch of knowledge of a subject or discipline. In essence, that's what astrology is: the study of the stars and planets and how their movements and patterns influence both mundane events and the lives of the inhabitants of planet Earth. From an esoteric and spiritual standpoint, it's believed that we all possess both a physical and an astral body. We move through the physical realm with our physical body while still inhabiting our astral body. We move through the astral world with our astral body, freed from our physical body. When we dream and when we die, we leave our physical body behind and move through an astral world more in tune with our eternal consciousness. The main definition of astral is of relating to or coming from the stars. It's likely to be this belief that motivated the ancients to start observing the position of celestial bodies the moment a soul incarnates, the moment we take our first breath. Over time, they've noticed that certain positions and patterns resulted in certain personality types and life events. Crucially, it revealed hints about our karma in this lifetime. In turn, this opens a gateway to living in alignment with our authentic selves, driving us to live a life that's both fulfilling and liberating. So what is karma? Is it a bitch? Karma is a Sanskrit word that essentially translates to action, work, or deeds. Whichever work or action we put forth would inform the fruit of our labor. If it's moralistically bad, then you can expect to be at the receiving end of the consequences of bad karma. If it's moralistically good, then you can expect to reap good karma. However, karma reveals far more than this in astrology. When we look at an astrological birth chart, we can see where one would be challenged to work on and improve continuously in this lifetime, for which one would ultimately be rewarded whenever it's time to reap the harvest. In traditional astrology, we can find the focus of one's life's work and life challenges by looking at different elements and combinations, including the moon, as well as the north and south nodes. In astrology, the north and south nodes are a representation of our inherited gifts and our comfort zone, as depicted by the south node. By exploring the qualities the north node represents, the path we're meant to move towards using those gifts and natural talents is revealed, as depicted by its sign and house placement in the birth chart. as any astrologist will tell you, this is a crucial part of delineating our karmic path when using astrology as a tool in pursuit of further self-development and the unveiling of one's life path. However, the primary placement that reveals essential truth and the roots of one's karma and incarnation is the planet Saturn and the role it plays in the birth chart. Simply put, in astrology teachings in both the East and West, astrology stands for living out our karma and manifesting a life for our highest good. It represents the actual work, karma means work, as mentioned earlier, we're meant to carry out during our incarnation on Earth in order to fulfill the conditions of a life well lived. With Saturn, however, we only learn what this work or karma is through pressurized life lessons and experiences that endow us with more maturity, self-containment, and a broader life perspective. In turn, the Saturnian life lessons form a crucial foundation for the footprints we leave behind in this world, no matter how big or small our contribution to a healthier society. This is why all Saturn transits bring with them some type of additional burden or major life lesson, so that we may enhance our abilities to withstand life's pressures while coming closer to living out our life's purpose in service of a better world. Your birth charts and how to read it. Your birth chart is a celestial snapshot, or an astrologically observed moment in time from the second you were born or took your first breath. At that moment, the timer for your karma and everything that helps you achieve your life's work was set and you were ready to go. Celestially, at that very second, the planets and constellations were arranged in a particular way from the standpoint of planet Earth. On the eastern horizon, a sun was rising at a specific degree. This is your rising sign, which is also referred to as the ascendant. From there, the birth chart is divided into 12 sections, correlating to the energies the 12 zodiac signs represent. In astrology, these 12 sections are called the houses. The ascendant marks the start of the houses, thus representing the first house. At that same moment, as the baby and the rising sign were rearing their heads, there were 9 planets, 7 in traditional astrology, that were transiting particular signs at a specific degree. The way that these planets are arranged from the viewpoint of your ascendant further helps to delineate the birth chart and reveal another piece of your cosmic DNA. Like we just uncovered, there are 12 houses and 12 zodiac signs. Astrologically, they correlate to each other and unveil specific themes not only cosmically, but also on a mundane level, both inevitably intertwined and enmeshed in the fabric of our existence. The extent of how much this is true, especially when studying any esoteric system, seems to be never-ending, mimicking the concept that the more we know, the less we know, as each uncovered piece of knowledge leads us to want to dig deeper on our quest for truth. The 12 zodiac signs are each ruled by a planet. Each of these planets, just like the houses, carries a certain energy and brings this energy wherever it is placed in the natal charts. When trying to uncover Saturn's role in our charts, and therefore our life's challenges and areas of focus during our Saturn return, we must locate Saturn's placement in the birth chart. Does it sit in the second house? The fourth house? Once we've identified this, we need to delineate it further astrologically to understand its degrees, aspects, and so on, which is a whole subject in itself. However, just by understanding your natal Saturn placement, you'll be surprised by how much this reveals about the area of your life that will require most attention during your own Saturn return. Which brings us to the central question of this book. What is a Saturn return? Before we carry on, though, you'll need your birth charts at hand in order to find where Saturn sits in your charts. There are lots of places online you can cast your own birth chart for free. Simply type astrological birth charts into your preferred search engine. illustrated as an example chart of a randomly selected date of birth. This is what your birth chart would look like, except that yours will likely have different placements and sun arrangements. In this chart, if you look closely, you'll find a symbol that looks like a sickle. That's the symbol for Saturn. In this example chart, you'll find the symbol, Saturn, and the house indicated by the number 9. So, in astrology, we'd say Saturn sits in the 9th house. If you look at the table below the chart, you'll find a list of planets. Look for Saturn. In this case, Saturn has next to it 10 degrees Capricorn. So we know that Saturn was transiting the sign of Capricorn. The 10 stands for the degree it was in. So to make conclusion of Saturn complete, we'd say Saturn sits in the 9th house in the sign of Capricorn at 10 degrees. Your turn.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.